Welcome to our daily devotion. The Methodist Church of Barbados invites you to sing, pray, and worship with us as we declare God's glory and celebrate His mighty acts.
Dear Heavenly Father, we want to start by saying, thank you, Lord, for giving us life today. Each morning as we open our eyes, we are truly blessed to see another day, to hear the birds chirping, to feel the sun's warm rays on our skin, or even the rain as it waters the soil and brings forth food for us to eat. Sometimes, it's the simplest things in life that brings us joy. However, majority of the time, we tend to forget this because of the pressures of life. Some of us are overworked, which leaves us mentally drained and can cause us to lash out at others who are close and dear to us. Lord, some of us are out of work and are looking for jobs to provide for our families, especially in these economically challenging times. But because jobs are hard to find, some of us go into a state of depression. Lord, remind us that you will always provide for us, even when we see it impossible. God, when I was a young boy, I was always taught to share and help others. And now that I am grown, I still carry this trait with me. However, sometimes it's easy to be caught up with our own burdens and we become blind to see others who are silently crying for help. Help us to recognize that help doesn't have to be financial, but rather it can be in the form of a listening ear or prayer. Guide us to your word, Psalm 46 verse 1, which reads, God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. So today, whatever problems we face, we should never forget that we aren't alone, because you, dear Father, are with us always. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
A reading from 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 17 to 24. After this, the son of the woman, the mistress of the house, became ill. His illness was so severe that there was no breath left in him. She then said to Elijah, "What have you against me, O man of God? You have come to me to bring my sin to remembrance and to cause the death of my son." But he said to her, "Give me your son." He took him from her bosom, carried him up into the upper chamber where he was lodging, and laid him on his own bed. He cried out to the Lord, "O Lord my God, have you brought calamity even upon the widow with whom I am staying by killing her son?" Then he stretched himself upon the child three times and cried out to the Lord, "O Lord my God, let this child's life come into him again." The Lord listened to the voice of Elijah. The life of the child came into him again, and he revived. Elijah took the child, brought him down from the upper chamber into the house, and gave him to his mother. Then Elijah said, "See, your son is alive." So the woman said to Elijah, "Now I know that you are a man of God, and that the word of the Lord in your mouth is truth." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Beloved of the Lord, I greet you in the name of Jesus Christ, head of the church and savior of the world. I want to share with us tonight a third message in a series on the life and ministry of the prophet Elijah. And I entitled tonight's message, Calamity in Zarephath. Calamity in Zarephath. Let us pray. Lord God, we give you thanks that you are the giver of life and that you sustain our lives even through the changing scenes of life. We bless you that you are our all in all, and even when life takes certain twists and turns, that we can trust that you are with us all the way. And so, Lord God, you know the deep places through which our lives must go. Help us when we enter them to lift our hearts to you, to be patient when we are afflicted, to be humble when we are in distress, and grant that the hope of your mercy may never fail us, and the consciousness of your loving kindness may never be clouded nor hidden from our eyes. And so speak now, O God, in this moment as only you alone can. Uphold me that I may raise up the name of Jesus, and that Jesus alone may be glorified in this moment. Let the words of my mouth and the reflections of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O God, our strength and Redeemer. Amen. Brothers and sisters, as we continue to journey through this passage in 1 Kings chapter 17, we have already considered that in the midst of a drought, God sent the prophet Elijah to Zarephath, where he had commanded a widow to feed his servant. Elijah finds her and directs her to bring him a morsel of bread in her hand. She replies, "As the Lord your God lives, I have nothing baked, only a handful of meal in a jar and a little oil in a jug. I am now gathering a couple of sticks so that I may go home and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die." In the end, God works a miracle through Elijah, keeping the jar of meal and oil from emptying. As we reflect on that passage, probably the most devastating verse in Scripture reads this way, that we may eat it and die. And that particular verse has stuck with me for a very long time. However, I bless God tonight that the story of this widow and her son does not end at that point. And that indeed, as Elijah lived in her house, that she had an opportunity to encounter the God of Elijah and see God at work in her life, sustaining her throughout the drought. But once again, there is calamity in her life and in the life of the prophet Elijah. As we pick up the story for this evening, we read that after this, the son of the woman, the mistress of the house, became ill. His illness was so severe that there was no breath left in him. Having nearly starved to death and having already lost her husband some unstated time before, this poor woman now has to watch her only child die of a dreaded disease.
The Bible tells us that his illness was so severe that it led to his death. Just when you thought that things couldn't get worse for this widow, her son dies. All of this is in 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 17 through to 24, as we've heard read moments ago. The Bible says that she is so distraught that she blames Elijah by saying, "What have you against me, O man of God? You have come to me to bring my sin to remembrance and to cause the death of my son." She was filled with grief. She was overcome by emotions. She very likely was angry and perhaps felt life was no longer worth the living. So when she saw Elijah, she didn't turn to him for comfort. She screams to turn on him. She said, "I wonder why you came into my life." Maybe she screamed at him, "What have you against me, man of God? Did you come to remind me of my sin and kill my son, my only son?" And brothers and sisters, when people can't see God, they often take it out on God's people. In this time of heartache and pain and grief and frustration, she turned on the very one who had been used by God to save her life and the life of her son. She's quick to blame Elijah, and even seems to blame herself. And so she asked Elijah, in essence, "Why did you come? Did you come to remind me of my sin and to take the life of my son?" In times of conflict and heartaches, we are quick to look for someone to blame. Blaming someone else seems to make sense of something that doesn't make sense. Sometimes we blame others, and at other times we blame ourselves. It is common to strike out rather than to look up. If you talk to people, you will learn how often this happens. For example, a physician cares for family for generations, and family turns around and sues him because a loved one dies. An employer bends over backwards to take care of his employees and then is sued by a former employee. A teacher tries to show love to her students and get in trouble or crossing the line. A pastor marries, buries, baptizes family members, but all of that is quickly forgotten when there is a disagreement in the church. A parent sacrifices over and over and over again for a child, and then the child says they want nothing more to do with the parent because one day, just one day, they couldn't have their own way. What an effect this must have had on Elijah. I mean, he had trusted God to feed him with ravens. He had trusted God to give him water from a brook. When the brook dried up, Elijah had followed God's call to Zarephath. There he had submitted to the humiliating thought of being fed by a widow. He had trusted God, and miracles came as a result. He had seen God do the impossible. He had even watched as God worked in the heart of a pagan widow woman and brought her to the place of faith in the God of Israel. He had watched the Lord feed her and her family through the time of a terrible drought. Now this woman's son is dead, and she points her finger of accusation at him. It is you. You brought this calamity upon me. You came into my house and gave me false hope. It is you. It must have been very discouraging for the man of God, for Elijah. The thing that is impressive, however, about Elijah's faith is that he doesn't defend himself. He doesn't try to explain the situation. Elijah is falsely accused, but he does not put up a defense for himself. I'm sure the accusations hurt and hurt deeply, but he doesn't retaliate. He doesn't get upset and attack her. He doesn't begin to call her name and call her ungrateful. He doesn't lash out at this widow. Elijah's heart has been touched by the pain this widow is experiencing. He has watched her grow in her faith. He has experienced her generosity. He has enjoyed her hospitality, and his heart is moved at her need. His heart is moved by her pain. His heart is moved with compassion by her grief. And he responds with incredible gentleness and grace. He simply asks for the widow to give her son to him. Then he takes the boy to his room and places him on his bed, and then said to God, "Oh Lord, my God, have you brought calamity even upon the widow with whom I am staying by killing her son?" Up until this point, Elijah hasn't had to do much. He moved when God said to move. He stayed when God said to stay. He ate when God provided. All Elijah had is basically to watch God do the impossible time and time again. However, Elijah, the man of God, is now placed in a position where he must get personally involved in what God is doing. He's brought to a place where he must trust God for what God is about to do, which God had never done before, or at least in his presence. And he must now get personally involved. He must now get his hands dirty. He must now get down on his knees and personally intervene on God's behalf. In theological circles, the problem of evil and suffering is a very, very difficult one. We don't have time to explore all the possible explanations for why bad things happen to good people. We think we know why bad things happen to bad people. However, the one thing that we need to remember is that God is not the cause of our suffering. God is not the cause of our pain and our loss. Many times we do not know why bad things happen. Why do some people get cancer? Why do accidents happen that take the lives of young and vibrant persons? Why do some people lose their jobs and then all that they have? We have to admit that we do not have the answers to the why questions most of the time. As a matter of fact, sometimes the only assurance that we are given in the midst of our questions is the fact that God is God. And the fact that God is with us. You see, the Jews have a rich tradition of both arguing with God and knowing the presence of God. So when Elijah questions if God caused the boy's death, he's engaging in a typical Old Testament Jewish cry called lament. Lament is a protest at God in its anger and pain. But then God comes to those who are hurting without rebuke, and God comforts them. God may not avert every tragedy that comes into our lives, but God is present with us in the midst of those tragedies, ready to comfort and care for us always by our side. And that is why St. Paul declares, since God is for us. When Elijah prayed for that little boy, Elijah submitted himself completely to God. In himself, the prophet had no power to bring this child back to life. He doesn't demand anything from the Lord, nor does he name it and claim it. He humbly asks God, let this boy's life return to him. That was as much as he could do, because Elijah recognized that the rest was up to God. And maybe God is speaking to you right now about something that has troubled you. Maybe God is speaking to you right now about a situation in your own life that you have been crying out to God about. Like Elijah, you need to come to the place that, having prayed, having committed yourself, having surrendered your heart, your life, your situation to the Lord, that you too need to recognize that the rest is up to God. The rest is up to God. And God would have me say to someone tonight, the rest is up to God. And so Elijah calls on the Lord with great boldness. With great boldness, he called upon the Lord, knocking on the door of the Almighty. But it's a boldness born out of faith. His boldness doesn't come from thinking that he deserves to be heard. It's a boldness born from faith. Faith that knows the Lord's forgiveness. Faith that knows God's generous invitation to cast all our cares upon him. Faith that comes in all humility and humbleness, confessing our unworthiness, relying on God's mercy alone, clinging not to anything in our hands, but simply to the cross we cling, clinging to nothing but the Lord's promise, the Lord's goodness, and the Lord's grace. Elijah came to God with great faith in God. And as Elijah prayed, and as Elijah placed his body upon the child's dead body, and Elijah trusted and believed God, and three times Elijah did that, and the boy was restored to life. The boy and his mother are reunited. And the widow says, now I know that you are a man of God, and that the word of the Lord in your mouth is truth. So in the end, the widow's faith is strengthened. Her son is restored to life, and Elijah's standing rises in the midst of this experience. God is again preparing his servant for Mount Carmel. I'm not sure where you're at tonight. I'm not sure how and where your faith has been tested. I'm not sure if you find yourself tonight in a situation that seems impossible. I'm not sure if tonight you feel that God has set you up, that God has brought you into a situation which you've responded with great hope, expecting tremendous breakthrough. And that situation turns into calamity. And you know that in the face of it, there's nothing that you or any human being can do. My friends, God is still God of the impossible. God is still God who can do that which can't be done. God is still God above all and over all, and God is still God. And you can trust him. Tragedies have struck and will continue to strike, including God's people. And when they do, I want you to know and believe, my dear friends, that the Lord works strength through tragedy. That the Lord makes a way where there is no way. I invite you to embrace the faith that believes that God can still move the mountain. I invite you tonight to bring all your burdens to the Lord. To bring all your situations to the Lord. I invite you tonight to trust God with you. To trust God with your life. To trust God with your situation. May God give you all the grace that you need to overcome. Let us pray. Lord God, we are troubled by many things, and sometimes we fear for our faith. In our sorrows, we are inclined to forget you or to doubt your help. In prosperity and health, we are inclined to forget you or to take credit for our successes. Lord, we believe. Help our unbelief. Lord God, Holy Spirit, help us always to remember that you have called us by the gospel and brought us to faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. And that you have promised to keep us in the faith until that day. And so I bring before you now those who are bereaved, those whose life seems to be in a dark place, those who are struggling to believe. I bring them to you tonight, O God. And I pray that they may know that burdens are lifted at Calvary and that Jesus is very near. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My brother, my sister, God bless you.
I will praise the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. Do not put your trust in princes, in human beings who cannot save. When their spirit departs, they return to the ground. On that very day, their plans come to nothing. Blessed are those whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God. He is the maker of heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them. He remains faithful forever. He upholds the cause of the oppressed and gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets prisoners free. The Lord gives sight to the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the foreigner and sustains the fatherless and the widow, but he frustrates the way of the wicked. The Lord reigns forever, your God, O Zion, for all generations. Feed us, O God, from stores that never empty. Anoint us, O God, with oils that never fail. Brothers and sisters, go in peace, and may the God of peace go with you, now and forevermore. And the people of God say, Amen.
For being a part of our daily devotion. We trust it has been a blessing to you. Now together, let us hold fast to His word and may it dwell in all of us richly.